How you doing?
Years of rock and roll at the Agora Ballroom at Newport Music Hall.
As a big rock and roll fan, happy anniversary to the Newport.
Brought to you by Columbus State Community College. Columbus State, we have your future in mind. Crossroads Beer, uniquely brewed to be a very drinkable beer. Germain Toyota, Columbus' lowest price Toyota dealer.
The first Agora was in Cleveland. That has since moved locations. Mm-hmm. All the other Agoras are shut down, I believe, except this one. Columbus was the second Agora, and it has stayed, it is now the Newport Music Hall, but it stayed the same location. So it's been ongoing live rock and roll for 25 years. And it's all because of Hank. And Hank is a living legend. A lot of people don't
understand
that.
Yes, indeed, he certainly is.
But he started all the Agoras. He still got the Agora in Cleveland. He's the reason that I was able to get into this building. Hank Licani is a living legend.
He certainly is.
In the rock and roll business.
This place here goes back to silent movies. Remember, this was built in 1922 or 3. It was a state theater. The capacity at that time was almost 1,600, like 1,583 seats. And when we took it over, I remember Butch Cassidy and the Sundance Kid was playing there. We opened before the Kent State riots. And we were open for like 2 or 3 days. We had a problem with the city on an occupancy permit. We closed, and then we reopened again in June. That's how it happened. When we first came in here, there was a beautiful pipe organ. That's why these spaces on the left and right. The organ that was up in here had two levels, had just about every gimmick you could think of.
It's always been a good sounding room, and it's always been that good old Ohio audience, you know? Ohio is really good for rock and roll.
To me, the most educated audiences I've ever played for, to me, was New York, Memphis, Chicago, and here in Columbus. People know what you're doing. And they, if you screw up, know that too.
It was voted by the by Columbia Records and by other record companies that this was the number one showcase club in the country.
Everybody, the staff are nice. When you got the staff nice, you know that the management have to be. But God, when the reason he was there was to play for the people. So I may not be able to autograph everything, the whole club, but at least some of the people I like to shake hands. As the guy used to say, I like to press the flesh. I love to do that.
We'll be right back after these messages. We're back.
Ted Nugent was our first show, and we went live over WNCI.
Ted Nugent and the Amboy Dukes.
Yeah, I remember it, man. In fact, a guy brought in a 58 Les Paul. Supposedly he was gonna take it to Joe Walsh the next day.
Yep.
58 Les Paul, he wanted like $4,000 for it. I went, $4,000? I play Gibson Birdland, they cost $1,500 and that's obnoxious.
Yeah.
Take this 58 Les Paul and go sell it to Joe, which he did. Now the thing's worth $10,000. because I didn't remember that. I didn't realize that those incredibly spiritual chunks of wood were that valuable, but that's what happened 20 years ago when we played the Agora. First time in 1970.
Easy action.
Alice Cooper played here in August of 70. He came back in 71. I think Alice Cooper played here at least three times before he got out of what I call the station wagon and became a name. Grateful Dead, we did the week. In fact, when they came back from Easter vacation, it was like the next day we did the Grateful Dead here for two shows on the same day. And the response was incredible. We had buses that came from Chicago that pulled up front, and I'm talking about like three and four huge buses. I'll never forget that it was $7 to get in. It was $5.50 in advance, $7 to the door, because I was at the window when a guy came up with his girl and put 14 silver dollars down and said, "Is this okay?" And I looked at those 14 silver dollars and I said, "You better believe it is."
Spanish lady comes to me, she lays on me this rug. It rained more fire around and round the tremble than explode.
Beach Boys resurfaced, and I believe it was in 1971. They played Carnegie Hall for a week, and they sold it out. On their way back to California, they stopped here and did two shows for us, and sold it out capacity. But they jammed North High Street. I mean, you could not drive on North High Street. That's the crowd we had outside, because the first and second show both came early. We must have had 5,000 to 7,000 people out there. Those years stand out the most because, you know, there was so much confrontation in 70. There were riots in the streets, and I remember we were tear gassed in this place probably six times at least, and every time that tear gas would come in the front door and come in this room, we would stay here. I remember the one riot and this huge crowd going down North High Street, just breaking all the windows, all the way down. They never touched the Agora. I stood out in front and watched this huge crowd go by. It was like watching a swarm of locusts go over a grove and leaving one bush. They never touched the Agora.
Humble Pie, I think we lived between all the, we lived in Ohio and kept on going between, you know, here and Cleveland and Toledo, right? We just seemed to go from one to the other. So yeah, it was like home for us.
Peter Frampton played here many times because every time I played him in Cleveland, I would book him Cleveland, Columbus, Cincinnati, and once in a while into Toledo.
I mean, to be honest, I've played here so many times that to say which was the first time as me, it's probably sort of cross-collateralized with Humble Pie, if you know what I mean, so played here a lot.
Peter Frampton played so many times for me that people thought he was a local act almost. I mean, he was good for at least two or three plays a year.
I've had my shelf that kicks in my bed, but I've come through. We are the champions.
Queen played here, and Mahogany Rush was the opening act. The only problem is that when Queen filled this stage, there was 8 feet left between the edge of their drum platform and the front of the stage. Mahogany Rush, who has a guitar player that is all over the place, they couldn't set up. And there was a huge argument in my office between the road manager from Mahogany Rush and the road manager from Queen. And they kept coming back down here, and the people from Queens said, "Absolutely not, we're not moving anything." And the windup was Mahogany Rush didn't play that night.
Is you wrong?
Now, Wednesday night was our Welfare Wednesday. That was the night that you paid $2 to the door, you came in and drank beer all night free. And one of the groups was REO Speedwagon. They used to come in all the time. They became one of my regular groups. James Brown has played here a number of times, yes. All the way up into, maybe the last time he played for us was 1984. David Bowie has performed here. The one thing I remember about the show is that I gained a lot of respect for David Bowie on that show. I mean, here is this huge star playing with Iggy Pop, which, you know, I guess he's a star, but it was questionable. He wasn't really drawing people. But David Bowie played the piano. Never once did he look up at the audience. I mean, he kept his head down and just was a piano player. Lou Reed played here. I don't remember the first time he played, but I believe it was in the spring of 71.
Yeah. You want to talk about a bizarre character?
I got a Lou Reed story. I can't tell you that.
I know it. We can't tell it.
I'll be glad to tell you that story. I'll get sued. Story on Todd, and I think it's a story that he will never forget. The night before Todd Rundgren, one of his road people came in, and he wanted to show me how good he was, and he wanted to clean up all our gear, so he completely tore our board down, took all our amps off the racks, and stripped all our stuff down, ready for cleaning and repairing, and he had it all over the floor. The next day, Todd Rundgren comes in, and here's everything all stripped, our board is stripped, everything. Todd Rundgren stayed up all night and put our entire system back together again. And did the show.
Todd Rundgren has played here for however long he's been around.
Yeah, Todd. And you know what? He's done everything from a cappella to the full-blown choir and orchestras.
Yep.
B.B. King became, the first time we played him during the vacation. It was like 2 weeks before Christmas. And because we used to gear it towards the local Columbus audience. And it became like the following year before Christmas, the following year, you know, he'd be playing for us.
I
I was born on a plantation and I worked hard there. I've been a disc jockey for many years, so I work hard there. But I've never been bitter because it seems to me that the doors that are open because of what groups like U2, the Beatles, and many other groups did. Because prior to them, at one time, from where I came from, it was almost against the law for whites to even listen to the type of music that I play. And when guys like the Beatles, Elvis Presley, and many of the people that was doing rock and roll came on the scene, this opened up a lot of doors for me, I know. I can speak for B.B. King. But you're gonna have a few, you know, that's kind of like Lucille, that ain't gonna never wanna do nothing, right?
Some very big acts that have gone through here.
We played the Gods when they first surfaced. That was like in the, I'm gonna say that they probably formed somewhere around 74.
The actual night that the Gods got a record deal. We got a record deal at that club. We'd never been in a studio before, ever. The show that sticks out in my mind the most, and probably always will be Kiss opening for Rory Gallagher. And, I mean, you couldn't have two more mismatched acts. The lights went out during the show. There were tornadoes that night. And there was a big thunderstorm out, and the lights in the club went out, and Gene Simmons had his candelabra on the stage with real candles on it. So when they were real primitive then. They're still in leather and things. And he handed candles out to the audience for people to see.
And you just look at other people, you can say, I saw them here. I remember standing there going, looking around, saying, my God, this is Stephen Stills on stage.
Yeah, yeah. Well, you know? The same thing happened when we did Bo Diddley and Ron Wood. I remember standing there going, that's a Rolling Stone.
Police played it when they first came over to this country, yes. They were in a truck and station wagons. And they toured the country that way. And they played here, I believe, around 1979.
You know, it's hard, what can I say? I've had a tremendous history here in front of the Agora, now the Newport. I developed bad posture here. I had got a few rashes, unfortunately, back in from 67 to 70. I saw some great rock and roll.
We're talking about all these great names. You know who we gotta talk about now?
Terrible Ten.
Terrible Ten.
Yes, the true Motor City Madman.
He opened the Agora in 70.
I ain't even warmed up yet.
We brought him back for our 20th anniversary. And you always heard about Ted's the loudest act you'll ever hear. He said, Scott, go get your sound man for me. We walked in the dressing room, Ted's back was to us. He was tuning his guitar.
Okay.
He turned around, stuck the butt of his guitar right in our sound man's face, and said, do you have any relatives that live here in Columbus? And Tim goes, yes. He goes, if you don't turn it up as loud as it'll go, I'll hunt him down and kill him. And he turned back around and kept tuning. And Tim was like, white.
Well, I remember when we did the 20th year anniversary here, it was like,
the first time. It was like tonight. It was like the 10th time. There is a certain spontaneous combustion that takes place when you're in a room that has a reputation, but the reputation isn't just this flitting concept in the night. It really is based on the human contact with this building. And I'd like to think that Columbus is a suburb of Ted's world anyhow, because I've got a real connection here. I really believe in this working hard, playing hard commando network in the heartland of America. And I've been playing here since I invented rock and roll back in the 50s. I want substance over symbolism. I want something I can grab onto. I want something that enhances my level of awareness. I want something that enthuses my spiritual connection with whether it's the bow and arrow, my child, the air around me, or that guitar. Repeat after me, firestorm of passion. Thank you very much. If you don't have a firestorm of passion, you're country and western. And if I have a cure, I have a cure. It's called Wang Dang Sweet Poon Tang, dinner music for the vital.
Hi, this is Joe Walsh, backstage at the Newport. Stick around, we'll be back with more rockin'.
Some things are left unspoken, some things are handed down. The circle stands unbroken, sending it back around. I looked out this morning.
Well, I love this place, and there's a couple places that I've played for years and years, and I always kind of just think, if the world ends, you know, this place will still be here, and that, you know, that gives me strength. I hate when you go back and it's an old condemned and, you know, boarded up and stuff. And I hope that never happens here.
I wrote this song about Columbus, and I figured it's important to play it.
It would have been the third, fourth, and fifth grade. I went to Crestview School, and I think it's still there. And I lived out on Summit Street. Those are some of the greatest memories of growing up. You know, those were the days before I really discovered women, you know. That was that one naive and innocent summer when you played Kick the Can, you know. And I wrote a song called Indian Summer, actually, which is on But Seriously, Folks, which is the one where I'm underwater, and it's called Indian Summer. And that was about that one summer.
Sometimes I'm still at the fishing hole. Far away. And you never needed bait where we used to go. Just a safety pin hook and a bamboo pole. Throw the little ones back, take the big ones home.
But I love this place because there's an intimacy you can't get playing the big places. And everybody has a good seat. The balcony's really fun. I mean, if I had my choice, I'd be up in the balcony.
And you as it used to be, finding time to let my mind wander.
It's important that some of us old-timers keep going to show younger musicians that you can realize peace and enjoy the benefits of success and still have some brain cells left. You know, the pace is a little fast.
Walk in front of this theater, worry about exams, who's coming this week. This place actually was a... I think it had a lot to do with my bad acume, quite frankly, because, you know, why study? You know, why pull an all-nighter when you can come to the Newport, come to the Agora, and you know, and just party and hear some rock and roll.
We did comedians as opening acts with groups didn't call for a rock act to open, or they were too big and there wasn't enough room on the stage. And we had quite a few comedians. We had some really nice rock comedians. My mama talking to me, trying to tell me how to live. But I don't listen to her because my head is like a sieve.
Not that many comics back in the late 60s, early 70s, but now, obviously, I'm going to be there. I call the stage prison. It's doing time.
Yeah, I'm not a good role model for impressionable youth.
In fact, I even saw Bill Haley in the comments, and I was convinced that Bill Haley had a toupee curl, because he has a legendary curl. I'm not sure if he's alive, but, you know, he's sort of one of the founders of rock and roll. But he did have a curl, and I was sitting right by the stage here, and the curl was almost 12 inches long. It was like a frightening, like almost like a 3D, a toupee curl. It was legendary.
Tell me if you've heard this rumor.
Mm-hmm.
This is what was rumored. Right before you took over the club,
mm-hmm.
that it was going to become like a mini shopping mall?
Yes, exactly.
Anchored by a drugstore?
Yep, exactly.
That was true?
That was true.
You saved it.
And, well, what happened was I had an internship with Bill Graham,
okay.
came back, finished up school at Ohio State, went back to work for a production company out there. That's where I raised the capital
okay.
in order to buy the old Agora.
Did it ever come down to the wire where the people wanting a shopping mall were bidding
yeah,
against
well,
you
this is
stuff?
What happened.
Uh-oh.
There was a bidding war, and I remember I had Nick Leconte, the older brother of the Leconte
okay.
family, on the phone, and he was saying, I'm sorry, Scott, but we're going to sell it to these other people, and they're going to turn it into a drugstore shopping mall. And I said, Nick, before we do this, can you get Hank on the phone? So we talked it all out, and Hank was the one who said, okay, Scott, if you send me a deposit, overnight me a deposit, then it's yours.
Wow.
But it was literally,
it was
if I wouldn't have asked, will you please get Hank on the phone, it was done.
Scott, you know, we're standing where there might have been the cotton balls or something.
Yeah, yeah.
You know,
exactly.
Q-tips,
yeah.
swabs.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay, ready, let's go, whoa!
Just flashing back to opening day, I remember Neil Young, it was so different. You walked in and you had the little palm trees.
Mm-hmm.
Palm trees still down there?
Yes, uh-huh.
the
we
end.
Got the palm trees. Uh-huh.
And that was about the only thing different. A lot of the other stuff wasn't in, but
mm-hmm.
it was clean.
Mm-hmm.
And that flipped people out right
yeah,
off the bat.
Yeah.
And people were nice to you when you came
yeah,
in.
Yeah.
And that flipped people out.
Yeah.
And it was such a feeling. And you know what, man? Not only was it Neil Young, but it was just a feeling that, yeah, this is, you know, an old, like something that, you know, near and dear to me, this is like an old friend
mm-hmm.
that's been rehabbed,
mm-hmm.
you know? So it's the same old friend, but brighter and better and happier.
Well, we went through a change. We didn't want to necessarily change the venue that much.
Right.
Keep it the live. And that's what has led it to be the longest running rock club in the country. Keep the same, more or less, feel of the live entertainment at the Agora, but we felt we needed to change the name in order to help change the image that had
right.
come along in the late 70s. So we took down the huge sign, Agora sign out front. We made a big press day over that.
I remember that.
Everybody in the business, from the acts, from the Bruce Springsteens of the world, to the tour managers, to the production managers, to the stage hands. Anybody who's in the music industry has probably been through this building at one point or another. So they all can relate to, oh, the old Agora on High Street.
You know, Scotty, was amazing too. You had artists that would come to town that no doubt could have done bigger venues. They always came here.
Yeah.
Zappa.
Yeah. Zappa, I don't know how many times he played the old Agora,
right.
But he was one of our first shows.
Uh-huh.
Michigan football weekend of 1984.
84.
We did the Michigan, showed the game in here.
So that game was home because they're home on even years.
And then the next day, we had two shows with Frank Zappa. And now, since then, his sons have come back. And last year, or this past year, 1994, they, Dweezil and Ahmet, played.
It's just amazing. Zappa's choice, you know,
yeah.
It had to be the Newport.
Yeah.
Well, I'm about to get sick from watching my TV. I've been checking out the news until my eyeballs fail to see. I mean to say that every day, it's just another rotten mess.
Oh no.
And when it's gonna change, my friend, is anybody's guess.
I know you remember this. Do you remember the killer, Jerry Lee?
Oh yeah.
Here's a guy who's freaking...
Jerry Lee Lewis.
He's missing his liver and his up back, swinging at a bottle of Canadian Club.
Yep. He was sitting in the dressing room. I went up to tell him that it was about time to go on. He was supposedly off of drinking.
Right.
But he had a little bottle next to his Coca-Cola.
Just mixing it in.
And he was sitting there talking, not directly to himself, but in the mirror about Elvis and bitching Elvis out.
For leaving
about
us.
Something. I don't know.
Whoa.
And I remember coming in and waving my hand in front of his face saying, Jerry, it's time for you to go on. He was like, oh, okay.
Stay tuned. We'll be right back. Shut up, Lucille. They will.
Petty was Meatloaf's opening act here one time.
You know what? I was going to say Meatloaf.
Meatloaf's another one who's played here.
I was going to say Meatloaf.
For years.
And always put on great shows.
Yep. Oh, he's a great guy. He was always upbeat. And we've always had great shows.
Mm-hmm.
One time there was a bad storm and we lost power. And he had to stop in the middle of his show.
I remember that.
I remember hanging out back with him and Officer Al. I got Officer Al some cardboard and we rolled it up like a megaphone. And he went out on stage and spoke to the audience and said,
because of the crowd.
Hang tight, we'll get the power up any minute.
I remember
and
that.
Meatloaf was out in back alley hanging out with me, all dripping, sweaty. As soon as the power came back on, went back in and
it's
jam.
Funny, we start talking about these.
Those are stories that we could get into.
Do you know who else did some fine shows here? Melissa Etheridge.
Oh, yeah.
Yep. Do you remember she had guitar problems?
And she sang a cappella.
She did Mercedes-Benz.
Mercedes-Benz.
She did a tribute to Janis Joplin.
Yep. And they got her guitar fixed, and she picked
Melissa
right back
Etheridge.
Up.
Won't you buy me a Mercedes-Benz? Oh, Lord, won't you buy me a color TV? Dialing $4 is trying to find me. I wait for delivery each day until 3.
Bruce Springsteen, the Black Crows.
J.D. Blackfoot.
Howard Jones. Palmer.
Yeah. Neil Young. U2. Green Day.
Hall & Oates.
Skid Row. David Bowie.
Bob Seger.
Pretender, some blasts from the past.
Grateful Dead.
Quicksilver Messenger Service.
War.
The Band.
Ted Nugent. Steppenwolf.
And the Beach Boys.
Average White Band.
And Country Joe.
Lou Reed.
The Monkees.
Remember the Monkees?
With Herman Hermits. Stephen Stills.
Remember Wasp?
Yes. Blackie Lawless.
AC/DC.
AC/DC.
Do you remember those?
With Bon Scott.
Yeah. on stage, they said, we're going to do another show. If you want tickets for the show tomorrow night, you can buy them on your way out. And they sold out the next night's show. McGuffey Lane.
Yeah.
We have play here every New Year's Eve.
They're still doing a New Year's.
Well, yes.
And according to Schwab, they'll keep doing it.
Yeah. Well, they
willing,
took
you know?
2 years when they broke up. Mm-hmm. They did their last show ever here at the Newport Music Hall. So they had played, I think, the first 6 or 7 New Year's Eves we had here at the Newport.
McGuffey Lane final
McGuffey
show.
Lane. Let me say for you goodbye. Well,
people
we've
that
had different
there. Mellencamp,
acts.
Thorogood.
Well, we've had acts like Michael Stanley. They don't know if it's the size of the stage versus how close the people
uh-huh.
are or what it is. But I remember Michael Stanley saying, this place has an energy that he doesn't feel in hardly any other place.
There's an aura about this building. I mean, too much has happened in here. And there's really a vibe. There really is. I noticed it when I walked in. I was just uplift of energy, and oh yeah, and I just knew, you know, there's no such thing as having a bad gig here. You can't. It won't let you.
Pretenders have played through the years.
And Huey.
Huey
loves
Lewis
the club.
The news. He came under the name the sports,
sports section.
Section.
Yes, indeed. I remember that
he
show.
He announced it as a sports section, sold out instantly.
Yeah. And now Devo was real wild, too.
Oh, Devo got all upset because
we had... They were ticked off at you for something, weren't they?
We had one of the greatest bands to ever come out of Columbus, Ohio, Ronald Cole and the Trillionaires. The drummer, I don't know which guy it was, he came up to my office and was furious and wouldn't even look me in the face. Just kind of was looking off into space, yelling, pounding this glove on my desk. Screaming about why did I have this high energy band in front of it.
I still crave this stuff like I did when I was a kid. I think the cute thing here is that I played the Agora in this hallowed hall, when it was called the Agora, back in the 60s and in the 70s, and then again in the 80s and in the 90s. Yow!
just the diverse shows.
Yeah.
I remember a Megadeth show here.
Yeah, oh yeah, Megadeth was probably...
Wildest stage diving I've ever seen.
Yeah, that was probably the most out of control I've ever seen it. Yeah, and if you come in these mosh shows, it looks like it's out of control, but it's all in control, except that Megadeth show.
That was a wild one.
Yeah, that was a wild one. Yeah, that was probably the most out of control feeling that everybody felt around here, what's going to happen. We shot an MTV video in here one time.
Who was
Hard
it?
To Handle for the Black Crowes.
Baby, here I am, I'm a man on the scene. I can give you what you want, but you got to come home with me.
Black Crowes shot most of it up at Alpine Valley and outside of Milwaukee, and then they came to the club the next night and finished it up.
Hey little thing, let me light your candle, cause the mama I'm sure all the hand and I just around.
Green Day had to sell out real quick.
Green Day sold out instantly.
And you know what's cool? You look at the bands nowadays like Green Day and how Green Day is. They're the Neil Youngs when Neil Young first got it off.
Oh, yeah. Well, I heard you crying loud. All the way across the sound. To be searching for that song.
You rocking? We're talking 25 big ones, kids. 25 years of rock and roll. Have you noticed you can't keep a good dog off your leg? So don't kick the puppy. Invite him in for the whole evening. Ted Nugent, rock and roll, 25 years, the spirit of the wild commando on duty.
Twenty-five years of rock and roll at the Agora Ballroom and Newport Music Hall. Brought to you by Columbus State Community College. Columbus State, we have your future in mind. Crossroads Beer, uniquely brewed to be a very drinkable beer. Germain Toyota, Columbus' lowest price Toyota dealer.
My job on the planet is to play guitar and play my music for people. As long as they come, I'll be there.
I want to hear that pounding in the distance, the uprising drums, as we hear in the background right now here at the almighty Newport Agora Get Down Nugent Hall of Gonzalitis.
And usually when you give what you've got the best that you can, the people are very nice. The accolades is tremendous.
I mean, if Benny Goodman can play Carnegie Hall when he's 82, we'll see what happens here.
Which means no drugs, no alcohol, no poisons, no pierced nipples.
I feel that when Lucille go in the case, the great master will be calling me away.
A quarter of a century?
Here's to 25 more years of rock and roll at the Newport.
So what? A quarter of a century, 25 years, one quarter, 25%? Big deal. I ain't even warmed up yet.